What's up, Transit? Good morning. My name is Reagan, and I am so excited that you are here. If it's your first time to Transit, welcome. Like Chuck and Lauren said earlier, we truly believe that Transit is the best place to be. So we're so happy that you're here to experience it. And this morning, we are wrapping up a series that we've been in for the past few weeks called On the Right Track, where we've been talking about our decisions and how they have the potential to affect tomorrow, the next day, and even years down the road. But before we get more into that series, I have a question for you guys. Do we have any Disney World fans in the room? Yeah. Quite a few of y'all. I am also a Disney World fan, but if we're being completely honest, my relationship with Disney World kind of got off to a rocky start. I've been to Disney World one time in my life, and it was right after I graduated high school. So picture high school Reagan learning she's going to Disney World for the first time. Guys, I was pumped. I was thinking about all the characters I was going to get to meet, the food I would be able to try, and I was especially excited for the fireworks show. I love fireworks, so that was something super exciting to me. But there's one really big part of Disney World that I failed to think about when I was planning for my trip, and that was the roller coasters, okay? Now, it's kind of hard to believe because I feel like roller coasters are a really big part of Disney World, but somehow I forgot about them, and that was a big deal because I was actually terrified of roller coasters and had never really been on one before because of how scared I was. So it was my surprise when I walk into Disney World on the very first day, our first park, and my family just books it to the first roller coaster. And so I'm in line, I have no idea what I'm about to get myself into. And not only was it my first roller coaster, but it was Expedition Everest, okay? Yeah, it's a great ride, but I had no idea what it entailed. And if you don't know anything about Expedition Everest either, this is what it looks like, okay? So I couldn't even see the roller coaster. I honestly thought I was just walking into another ride because there's this giant mountain, it's Mount Everest, and so I didn't know what I was getting myself into, but we make it through the line pretty quick. We're sitting on this roller coaster, and this is what happens during the ride. So you're kind of coasting up. Honestly, everything at this point is pretty good, having a good time. And then, yeah, you get to this part where the track looks like it's been broken, because apparently in the storyline, there's a Yeti who's come and, like, destroyed the track, and now there's no way forward. So to get back down, what do you have to do? You have to go backwards, exactly. So then you're taking off quickly, you're going quickly backwards, and then before you know it, you are in the pitch black darkness, and you're twisting and turning backwards, and you're going so fast, and before you know it, there's a Yeti yelling at you, and guys, it's a lot. Needless to say, it is not what I expected when I was planning or thinking through my Disney World trip. And maybe roller coasters are nothing for you. You love them, or maybe you don't care about Disney World, which you do you, I guess. But have you ever experienced this in another area of your life? Have you been in an unexpected circumstance or situation where you thought something was going to go one way and it completely went the other way and it's left you feeling lost or disoriented or confused? Now, I think it's probably safe to say we've all had something like this happen to us in life. Maybe you didn't make the sports team that you were hoping to. Or maybe you didn't get the part you auditioned for. Maybe one of your parents got a new job and now you have to move away from your friends. That happened to me in middle school. Or maybe your best friend has a new best friend and now you are left feeling lonely. Whatever your specific situation is, sometimes in these unexpected situations and circumstances, we find ourselves asking this question. What do I do when things don't go as expected? Because guys, the truth is a lot of life can feel out of control, especially in middle school when it feels like decisions are made for you or things just happen to you. But the truth is, even though that's the case, we are still making decisions, and these decisions really do still count. And there's one thing, one decision that no matter how out of control we feel, there's one thing we can still choose for ourselves. And we can discover what that one thing is in a book in the Bible that was actually a letter written by a guy named James. Now, James is the half-brother of Jesus, and he was pretty skeptical about who Jesus was for a big part of his life, but once he finally believed in who Jesus was for himself, he wrote this letter that we can still read today, and this is how he starts it. He says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds." So what James is saying here is that these trials or challenges or unexpected circumstances, whenever we're facing those, we can consider it pure joy. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read that and I hear it, it feels a little bit backwards. It feels like, how am I supposed to have joy when things, I'm going through a trial or a challenge? But what I do want to point out is that this joy that James is talking about here is different from when we feel happy about something. Because happiness is an emotion or a feeling that we get from the things happening around us. So we might feel happy when we get a good grade on a test, or we win an award, or we get to hang out with a friend. But joy is something different from that. Joy is actually an internal emotion. It's having a cheerful heart despite what's going on around you. So what James is saying is that when we're in these trials or challenges, we can choose to have joy. It's a choice. Now, I know what you might be thinking, why would I want to choose joy if the things happening around me are making me feel embarrassed or sad or disappointed? And that's a totally valid question. But there's another book in the Bible called Proverbs, which is a book written about wisdom and how to live your best life. And the writer Solomon writes this. He says, "A cheerful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones." So like we just talked about, a cheerful heart is another way to describe joy. And so Solomon is saying that joy is actually like medicine. It can be beneficial to your mind, to your heart, and to your body. But when we let the things around us hold us back, drag us down, or maybe even ruin our outlook on life, it can leave us with dried up bones. Now, when I have that image in my head, it's not exactly a pleasant image. I'm picturing someone weak or maybe even fragile. And it could be this physical weakness that Solomon's talking about, but it also could be a weak spirit or a weak faith. And that is not something that, at least me personally, that's not something that I really want. So when I'm in these unexpected circumstances and when we face these challenges and are in these places, we can choose joy because joy is a choice. Guys, you have a lot of power and control over your mind to be able to choose joy. We can choose joy because we know that God loves us, He is with us, and that He has a plan for our life. And those are things that you can choose to find joy in, because joy is the wise decision. Now, I want you to hear me when I'm saying this, that your feelings are not invalid. You shouldn't fake your feelings. You might be experiencing really difficult emotions because of the difficult things going on in your life, and those feelings are okay. In fact, if you've seen Inside Out 2, the new movie, or the first one, really great movie. So if you haven't seen it, you should watch it. But it's a great picture of how we have a lot of different emotions, but they can all exist at the same time. And with those emotions, joy is also always there because, like we talked about, it's an internal attitude that's not affected by the things happening around us. So the next time you're in an unexpected circumstance, you can choose to have joy. And maybe you don't know how to choose joy. It could be a lot easier said than done. But one way to choose joy, the first step in choosing joy, is to invite God in. Joy is what we call a fruit of the Spirit, which means it comes directly from God. So those of us who have chosen to follow God, we actually have access to joy because we have access to God and are connected to Him. So when we find ourselves in these places that we didn't expect to be, we can invite God into those places with us and ask him to bring joy. So inviting God in is a great place to start when it comes to choosing joy. And then the next step in choosing joy is to ask good questions. So when you find yourself in unexpected situations, these questions might be, how is God using my disappointment to point me in another direction? Or what could I be learning from this situation? Or maybe, how is God using my unexpected circumstance to help someone else in the future? When we ask good questions like this, we're actually finding purpose in our pain, and it makes us actually want to choose joy. And then the third step in choosing joy is to actually go and find it. Sometimes when we are dealing with these difficult emotions that we're trying to process, we become blinded by it and distracted from all of the other things happening around us. But the truth is that God has given us so many good things, and even if they feel really small. So to choose joy, we can shift our focus from being entirely on these difficult emotions we're feeling and actually start to see the good things too. So next time you find yourself in an unexpected situation where what you planned isn't what happened, and you feel lost or confused and you're processing hard emotions, which are okay, you can choose joy, because joy is a choice, by inviting God in, asking good questions, and then going to actually find the joy. So we are about to go talk about this more in small group, but first I have one question to leave you guys with, and then we'll head there. The question is, when was the last time you were surprised by something? So y'all can go ahead and start talking about that, and you are released to small group. We will see you next week. Thank you so much for being here.